Well, good morning. You're watching The Breakfast News on Rajya Sabha Television. I'm Ashwarya Kapoor, and here are the headlines. BJP releases first list of 36 candidates for Lok Sabha polls. 23 nominees from Andhra Pradesh, Sambit Patra, to contest from Puri. Party also announces a second list for Andhra Pradesh and Odisha assembly elections. Latest Congress list fields Raj Babbar from Fatehpur Sikri instead of Muradabad, Renuka Chaudhary to contest from Khammam, Telangana. Party also releases list of 54 candidates for Odisha assembly polls. Government boycotts Pakistan National Day event after its High Commission invites separatists to the reception. No separatists attend due to government crackdown. 8 terrorists killed in 4 different encounters in Jammu and Kashmir. Malaysia hosts the 28th Sultan Azlan Shah Cup 2019. Team India to take on Asian Games medalist Japan in the opening match today. Teams to watch out for are Japan, Korea and hosts Malaysia. And Shaheed Divas being celebrated today as a tribute to martyrs Bhagat Singh, Sukhdev and Rajguru. Vice President and Prime Minister Modi pay homage to all three. Venkaiah Naidu says their patriotism will continue to inspire every Indian. First up, let's get you all the election-related news. The BJP has released a fresh list of 36 candidates for the Lok Sabha polls, which included 23 nominees for Andhra Pradesh, where polling would be held in the first phase on 11th of April. The list announced late on Friday night also contained names of 6 candidates for Maharashtra and 5 for Odisha and 1 candidate each for Assam and Meghalaya. BJP national spokesperson Sambit Patra will contest the general election from Puri parliamentary constituency in Odisha. The party had released its first list of 184 candidates on Thursday, which confirmed that Prime Minister Narendra Modi will seek a re-election from Varanasi, his parliamentary seat. Meanwhile, BJP also released a second list of its candidates for the ensuing assembly elections in Andhra Pradesh and Odisha. The list contains the names of 51 candidates for Andhra Pradesh and 22 candidates for Odisha. Meanwhile, the Congress Party on Friday released a list of its 35 candidates for the Lok Sabha election. The party shifted Uttar Pradesh state unit chief Raj Babbar from Muradabad to Fatehpur Sikri, the party said in a statement. The party has also nominated Imran Pratap Grehia from Muradabad, where Babbar's candidature was announced earlier. The party fielded a former union minister Renuka Chaudhary from Khammam in Telangana. The party also fielded Vikramaditya Singh, the son of former union minister Karan Singh, from Udhampur constituency in Jammu and Kashmir. The Congress also released a list of 54 candidates for the Odisha assembly election. Meanwhile, the BSP or the Bahujan Samaj Party released its first list of candidates for Lok Sabha polls on Friday. The party has named 11 candidates in the first list. The BSP has fielded former JDS General Secretary Kunwar Danish Ali from Amroha. Ali had joined the BSP only last week. Mayawati's, remember, BSP is contesting 38 of the 80 Lok Sabha constituencies in Uttar Pradesh under the seat-sharing agreement with Samaj Party and the RLD or the Rashtriya Lok Dal. And the Shiv Sena on Friday declared its first list of 21 candidates in Maharashtra for the Lok Sabha polls. And in the list, the party has retained 17 sitting MPs. As per the pre-poll alliance, the BJP will contest on 25 seats and Shiv Sena on 23 out of the 48 Lok Sabha constituencies in Maharashtra. of these 23 seats, the Uddhav Thackeray-led party has announced candidates on 21. In 2014, the Sena had contested on 20 Lok Sabha seats in the state and had won 18.
शिवसेना भाजपा के उम्मीदवारों की जो सूची है जारी कर दी गई है 23 जगह शिवसेना लड़ रही है उसमें से 21 उम्मीदवारों की सूची आज जाहिर हो चुकी है दो उम्मीदवार अभी हम घोषित करना बाकी है एक पालघर और सातारा ये दोनों नामों की घोषणा दो दिनों में हो सकता है रविवार को ये जाहिर हो जाएंगे
News from Bihar, where the opposition's Mahagathbandhan has announced a seat-sharing formula for the Lok Sabha polls. And as per the agreement, Lalu Prasad's RJD will contest on 20 seats out of the total 40 Lok Sabha seats in the state. 9 seats will be fought by the Congress party. Rashtriya Lok Samta Party or the RLSP will field its candidates on 5 seats, while the VIP party will contest on 3 seats. Former Chief Minister Jitan Ram Manjhi's Hindustan Awam Morcha has also been given 3 seats. The candidates were also announced for the Lok Sabha seats that go to polls in the first phase. Former JDU President and NDA convener Sharad Yadav will contest on an RJD symbol and merge his party Lok Tantrik Janata Dal with it after the Lok Sabha polls.
सीटवार इस प्रकार है राष्ट्रीय जनता दल 20 कांग्रेस 9 इस आशय के साथ भी कि राज्यसभा की पहली सीट बिहार कांग्रेस की किसी नेता को जाएगी रालोसपा 5 हम 3 वीआईपी 3 और माले को 1 सीट राजद कोटे से गया हिंदुस्तानी अवामी मोर्चा प्रथम चरण का मैं दोहरा रहा हूं श्री जीतन राम मांझी जी नवादा राष्ट्रीय जनता दल श्रीमती विभा देवी जमुई रालोसपा श्री भूदेव चौधरी औरंगाबाद हिंदुस्तानी अवाम मोर्चा श्री उपेंद्र प्रसाद विधानसभा के उपचुनाव में दलगत स्थिति नवादा हिंदुस्तानी अवाम मोर्चा धीरेंद्र कुमार सिंह उर्फ मुन्ना डेहरी राष्ट्रीय जनता दल मोहम्मद फिरोज हुसैन
All right, let's get to some other news now. First up, news from Jammu and Kashmir, where a total of 8 terrorists along with a civilian have been killed in 4 separate encounters in the last 24 hours at separate places in Jammu and Kashmir. 2 Lashkar-e-Taiba militants were killed in a fierce gunfight with the security forces in Bandipora district on Friday. One of the terrorists killed in the encounter in the district's Hajin area was identified as Pakistan-based LET commander Ali Bhai. A 10-year-old boy who was held hostage was also killed in the encounter. Now, 2 more terrorists were killed in the encounter in Shopian's district's Ratnipora area on Friday. Security forces had holed up several militants inside a house in Ratnipora. A team of Special Operations Group and 34 Rashtriya Rifles of the CRPF were carrying out a cordon and search operation in the area. And in Sopor's Varpura area, security forces killed another terrorist after a gunfight on Friday. As a precautionary measure, internet services have been snapped in Shopia and Sopor, while in other parts of South Kashmir, it has been reduced to 2G. All the educational institutions have also been closed in Sopor. On Thursday also, 2 Jaish-e-Mohammed terrorists were killed in the encounter with security forces in Baramulla district, while 3 security personnel, including an officer, also suffered injuries during the operation. And in a major breakthrough, the Delhi police has arrested a top Jaish-e-Mohammed operative, Sajid Khan. He has been sent to NIA custody till 29th of March by a Delhi court. Sajid Khan, a resident of Pulwama, was arrested from the Red Fort area late last night. He is a close aide of Pulwama attack mastermind Mudassir Ahmed Khan, who is believed to have been killed in an encounter in Jammu and Kashmir on 11th of March. The police said that Sajid Khan was in contact with Mudassir Ahmed Khan and Pakistani terrorist Yasir also via an app using fake numbers. He was taken by Mudassir by establishing a sleeper cell in Delhi. Sajid Khan moved to Delhi before the Pulwama attack that killed 40 CRPF jawans in Jammu and Kashmir. And the government has boycotted a Pakistan National Day that is being marked today. Pakistan Day is celebrated to mark the Lahore Resolution on 23rd of March each year. While Islamabad will celebrate the day today, the Pakistan High Commission in New Delhi had organized events yesterday. India, however, did not send any representatives to the event as the separatists from Jammu and Kashmir were also invited. Indian diplomats in the Indian High Commission in Islamabad also will not attend the Pak National Day celebrations. Foreign Ministry spokesperson Ravish Kumar said that the decision was taken after Pakistan High Commission decided to call Hurriyat leaders to the reception. It added that in February, we were very clear that any attempt by Pakistan High Commission or Pakistani leadership to engage with the Hurriyat leaders will not be taken lightly. None of the separatists from Kashmir, however, attended the event this year as most of them either are in jail or under house arrest after a major crackdown by the government last month. The ones who are not jailed fear their arrest or another crackdown. Meanwhile, Pakistan Prime Minister Imran Khan said on Friday that Prime Minister Narendra Modi sent him greetings on the eve of Pakistan's National Day.
This time, because the Pakistani High Commission has decided, as I said, Hurriyat representatives to invite them, we have decided on the basis of their invite that we will not send any representative to the Pakistani High Commission mein, unke reception ke liye nahi bhejenge.
And the Yasin Malik-led Jammu Kashmir Liberation Front was banned by the Union Government, according to the Home Ministry. The party was banned for a series of violent acts and also being in the forefront of separatist activities in the militancy-hit state since 1988. The organization has been banned in... It has been named in 37 FIRs and is being investigated in several cases by Jammu and Kashmir Police as well as the NIA or the National Investigation Agency. Union Home Secretary Rajiv Gauba said that JKLF was banned following government's zero tolerance policy against terrorism. Yasin Malik is under arrest and he's at present lodged in Jammu's jail. Now, this is the second organization in Jammu and Kashmir to be banned this month. Earlier, the center had banned the Jamaat-e-Islami Jammu and Kashmir as well.
JKLF Yasin faction, as an unlawful association under the Section 3(1) of the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act 1967. This is in accordance with the policy of zero tolerance against terrorism, which is being followed by the central government. Government is committed to relentlessly pursuing the policy of curbing the activities of secessionist organizations, which are a threat to unity and integrity of the country. The National Investigation Agency and Enforcement Directorate are taking strong action against these organizations.
More news from Jammu and Kashmir. The Enforcement Directorate has slapped a penalty of 14.4 lakh rupees against a Jammu and Kashmir-based separatist Syed Ali Shah Gilani. The ED has also ordered confiscation of $10,000, which is nearly 6.8 lakh, in connection with the FEMA case. Now, the case pertains to Gilani in illegal possession of foreign exchange. The case is being investigated by the ED under the Foreign Exchange Management Act. The case was taken up by the ED on the basis of an Income Tax Department complaint against Gilani. A similar proceeding against another separatist, Yasin Malik, former chairman of a JKLF, is also underway. And right now, we'll take a very short break. We'll be right back with more news. Welcome back after the break. Oath-taking ceremony of Justice Pinaki Chandra Ghose as the chairman of the newly formed Lokpal will be held today at the Rashtrapati Bhavan. President Ramnath Kovind will administer PC Ghose's oath. Former Supreme Court Judge Justice Pinaki Chandra Ghose was appointed as the country's first Lokpal on 19th of March. The appointments were recommended by Prime Minister Narendra Modi-led Selection Committee and approved by President Ramnath Kovind. The Lokpal and Lokayukt Act, which envisages the appointment of a Lokpal at the centre and Lokayuks in the states to look into cases of corruption against certain categories of public servants, was passed in 2013. The government has exceeded its disinvestment target for the current fiscal by 5,000 crore rupees. Finance Minister Arun Jaitley announced on Friday that the disinvestment receipts have touched 85,000 crore rupees as against a target of 80,000 crore rupees for disinvestment for the current year. The government has mopped up 9,500 crore rupees from the fifth tranche of the CPSC ETF and 14,500 crore rupees from the REEC PFC deal. The disinvestment target for the next fiscal has now been fixed at 90,000 crore rupees. Net employment generation in the formal sector touched a 17-month high of 8.96 lakh in the month of January. According to the latest EPFO payroll data, around 76.48 lakh new subscribers were added to the social security schemes of the Employees Provident Fund organization from September 2017 to January 2019. The net EPFO enrollment in January 2019 stood at 8,96,516, which is the highest since September 2017. The addition in January was 131% higher as compared with 3.87 lakh EPFO subscribers added in the year-ago period. Shaheed Divas or Martyrs Day is being celebrated today as a tribute to martyrs Bhagat Singh, Sukhdev and Rajguru. Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu paid tributes to all the three on the day of their martyrdom. In a Twitter message, he said that the country will never forget their valour and unshakable commitment to freeing the country from alien rule. He added that their patriotism and acts of sacrifice will continue to inspire every Indian at all times. Prime Minister Narendra Modi also paid tributes to all the three freedom fighters. In a Twitter message, he said that India is proud that these three great men belong to our land. The PM also uploaded a video paying homage to all the three. Shaheed Bhagat Singh was an Indian socialist revolutionary who became a martyr at the age of 23. He still remains an inspiration for millions of people. He is considered one of the most influential revolutionaries of the Indian independence movement. He sacrificed his life for our country, and 16 years after his death, India won freedom. Bhagat Singh, Sukhdev and Rajguru fought for freedom of our country from the colonial rulers and sacrificed their lives on 23rd of March 1931. They were hanged to death by the British. Since then, every year 23rd of March is observed as Martyrs' Day, also known as a Shaheed Divas. Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu on Friday underlined that efforts should be made to nourish the young talent by providing them with research facilities, financial support and also by platforms to publish their articles and research papers on ancient Indian traditions, medicine, science, yoga and Indian arts, dance forms and culinary services. He also opined that compiling and consolidating academic research would help the current and future generations. Naidu was addressing the gathering after releasing the three-volume book, felicitating legendary archaeologist B.B. Lal. Naidu highlighted the importance of the magnificent sites in teaching the younger generation about the great heritage, archaeological skills, diverse culture and tradition of our country.
History, culture, heritage, they need to be preserved because that gives you inspiration. self confidence, Atma Gaurav. That's what is missing in our public life to some extent. This is our weakness. This is because of colonial rule. We must come out of that mindset. Yes, there has to be discussion, there has to be debate. You must have argument and counter argument. He says Mahabharata is having evidence. Let us discuss whether there is evidence or not. It is only a myth or not. You must be tolerant to the other opinion.
International news now. Syria has condemned President Donald Trump's declaration that Washington will recognize Israel's sovereignty over the disputed Golan Heights, calling the statement as irresponsible. Syria Foreign Ministry's statement said that Donald Trump's comments confirm the blind bias of the United States. It added that Donald Trump's statement won't change the fact that Golan was and will remain Arab and Syrian. Trump's announcement the day before was a major shift in American policy and gives Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu a political boost a month before elections. The administration has been considering recognizing Israel's sovereignty over the Golan Heights, which Israel captured from Syria in 1967. And Netanyahu had pressed the matter with visiting Secretary of State Mike Pompeo this week. News from Africa, where a week after the flooded Mozambique port of Beira was hit by Cyclone Idai, cases of cholera have been recorded. The International Federation of Red Cross and Red Crescent Societies have warned of the risk of other outbreaks as well, already noting an increase in malaria. The storm has so far killed 557 people across Mozambique, Zimbabwe and Malawi, but the death toll is expected to rise. Idai made landfall near Beira with 177 kilometers per hour winds on 14th of March. Aid workers are slowly delivering relief, but conditions are said to be extremely difficult, with some areas completely inaccessible. Some 1.7 million people are said to be affected across South Africa, with no electricity or running water in areas where homes have been swept away and roads have been destroyed by the floods. Sports now. The 28th Sultan Azlan Shah Cup is set to commence from today in Malaysia. The opening match will be played between India and Asian Games gold medalist Japan. India will try to make most of this year's cup as they finished fifth in the last edition of the tournament. India have won the title five times. Australia, which clinched the last year's Sultan Azlan Shah Cup title, is not playing in this edition of the tournament. The number of teams in this edition of Sultan Azlan Shah Cup will be the same, but this time round, Canada, Japan, Poland and Korea will be participating in the tournament, replacing the past tournament teams Australia, Argentina, Ireland and England. There will be a total of 18 matches in this edition of the tournament, and it will conclude in March. And with that, we wrap up this edition of Breakfast News. Thanks for watching.